Imagine a scenario where we've made contact with a group of friendly aliens. We spent a long time sending messages back and forth, teaching each other the things we know about the universe. At some point, we get around to discussing human greetings, like shaking right hands. But hold on, how will we define right versus left to our long-distance friends? Lucky for us, there's a physics experiment that can demonstrate right and left. So we teach them the experiment and they repeat it. Eventually, we decide our civilizations should meet, and you've been chosen as the human ambassador. As a gesture of goodwill, the alien reaches out to shake your hand, but they've held out a hand on their left side. Should you shake it? This scenario was posed by famous physicist Richard Feynman during a lecture, and it was repeated to me as a homework problem in my quantum field theory class. And the answer to this riddle is one of the most important discoveries in all of physics. An important lesson that we learn as kids is how to tell our right from our left. But as far as many of the laws of physics are concerned, it's a meaningless distinction. After all, right and left are just mirror images of each other. Like, if I turn my hands inward, my right hand turns counterclockwise while the left turns clockwise. The actions are mirrored, but I'm doing the same motion with both hands. A spiral galaxy looks like it's turning in a specific direction. But if you were to look at the galaxy from below, its rotation would appear to be a mirror image. In this case, all you did was change your perspective. No matter which direction it turns, or where you view the galaxy from, the laws of physics are the same. The forces that hold the galaxy together, and the forces that make the stars shine, don't seem to care how you define clockwise or counterclockwise. This right-left symmetry is what physicists call parity. And for a long time, physicists assumed that our world would be entirely indistinguishable from a mirror world, where right and left were flipped. Everything in this reversed world would still have all the same physics. In other words, they thought that right and left were just human distinctions. They assumed there was no objective way to define those things. Experiments had already shown that gravity and electromagnetism showed no preference for right or left. Neither did the strong force, which holds atomic nuclei together. But there was building suspicion that the weak force, the one responsible for radioactive decay, might violate the parity law. It took a clever experiment performed by an expert in radioactive decay to set things right. Left? Qiansheng Wu was born in China and came to the US in 1936 for graduate school. She received her PhD from UC Berkeley in 1940, and then, like many other physicists in America at the time, was recruited to work on the Manhattan Project. She ended up as a professor at Columbia University and became known as the leading expert in a certain type of radioactive decay called beta decay. Beta decay happens when a neutron turns into a proton, releasing an electron and an antineutrino in the process. Electrons are sometimes called beta particles, which is how the beta decay process got its name. In 1956, one of Wu's colleagues approached her with the idea of testing the concept of parity symmetry using beta decay. Some theoretical calculations had suggested that beta decay might not preserve parity, that it might reveal a true difference between our world and a mirror world. And Wu immediately realized the idea could be tested using radioactive cobalt atoms. Cobalt-60 atoms have 27 protons and 33 neutrons. They are unstable and decay into nickel-60 atoms. Her experiment would measure the direction the electrons were shed during the decay. The key was that cobalt-60 atoms can act like little compass needles. She had to make the experiment really cold so that the atoms wouldn't be jostled around by heat. But then she was able to use a really strong magnet to align the atoms with a magnetic field. By convention, physicists say that an atom aligned to the north pole of a magnetic field is pointing up, and that it is spinning in a counterclockwise direction when viewed from above. So with most of the atoms pointing north, and therefore spinning the same way, Wu was able to see which direction the cobalt atoms emitted electrons as they decayed. There were two possible outcomes. Either the electrons would fly to the north and south equally, indicating that parity doesn't matter, or they would favor one direction, meaning that it does. For hundreds of years, physicists would have predicted the electrons should have no preferred direction. Yet the experiment found that when cobalt atoms pointed north, the electrons tended to go south. This proved the weak force behaves differently than the other three fundamental forces, and it proved that nature does care about parity. To start with, this experiment showed that right versus left was more than just a human construct. If you have all the tools to build this experiment, then you can define right versus left in terms of physics. Put some cobalt atoms in a magnetic field, and tweak the field until electrons are mostly emitted in the same direction. Whichever direction your cobalt atoms are spitting out most of their electrons, call that south. That makes the opposite direction north. Now you can define right versus left. The magnetic field is created by loops of wire carrying a current. If you orient north so that it points from your feet toward your head, or whatever the alien equivalents are, then the current in the wire loop will be flowing away from you on the right side and toward you on the left side. Wu's experiment forced everyone to do a hard reset on their expectations of physics. Physicists quickly got down to the business of reworking their theories to accommodate the death of parity. From this chaos, important theories such as the standard model emerged, as well as electroweak theory, a single equation that can describe the electromagnetic and weak forces. Wu had revealed deep truths about the universe and sparked a million new questions. Her experiment has gone down in history as one of the most important in all of physics. Consequently, Wu, who was known to many of her colleagues as Madame Wu, was dubbed the Queen of Nuclear Research, the First Lady of Physics, and was often compared to Marie Curie. Before I tell you what all of this has to do with the left-handed alien, here's a quick ad.
Thank you for watching SciShow. Every time you watch one of our videos, it helps them get out to even more people. So thank you for supporting the channel with your time. And if that made you feel all warm and fuzzy, you'll love this next part. We have even more ways to support the videos you like to watch. Coming November 3rd, the second annual Complexly Learnathon is a celebration of learning and the free content we make here at SciShow, Crash Course, and all of Complexly. We're doing activities, videos, and live streams, and we have lots of opportunities for you to support our shows, including some very cool new merch. Mark your calendars and go to complexlylearnathon.com to check out the schedule of events.
The following year, in 1957, Wu's colleagues who worked on the theories of parity violation won the Nobel Prize in Physics, while she was left out. Even as they accepted their prizes, they acknowledged how critical her contributions were to the success of their theory. Systemic injustice aside, Wu's work made a lot of new things possible, including our riddle of the left-handed aliens. Once we teach them the experiment, then we'll share a common definition of left versus right, just like we'd be able to use experiments to agree on the speed of light or the definition of a hydrogen atom. So when we finally encounter the aliens in person and their ambassador reaches out a left hand, one of two things must be true. Either something was lost in translation, or the aliens come from the mirror world, where right and left are reversed. Now from a distance, a mirror world would look just the same as ours. Atoms, stars, galaxies, and even life could exist, just with the basic definitions of right and left flipped. But there is one catch about this hypothetical mirror world. The Wu experiment showed that the only way for right and left to be flipped is if the charge of every particle is also flipped. The atoms in the mirror world must be made of positively charged anti-electrons and negatively charged anti-protons. In other words, a mirror world is also an antimatter world. And when matter and antimatter meet, the result is a burst of energy as the particles annihilate each other. If there's a lot of matter and antimatter combining, let's just say you don't want to be nearby. So if the alien ambassador offers you their left hand, either they got really nervous and forgot which hand we prefer to shake with, or they've done the Wu experiment in a mirror world. And if they're from a mirror world, they must be made of antimatter, in which case you should certainly not shake hands, unless you want to be destroyed in a blast that releases 150,000 times as much energy as the Trinity nuclear bomb. This isn't just a silly hypothetical thought experiment. Okay, well, it mostly is, but this riddle also points to one of the biggest unresolved questions in physics. Where is all the antimatter anyway? Antimatter exists, and it's possible for mirror worlds to form from it. So where is all of it? In our neighborhood of the universe, there's a lot more matter than antimatter. After all, we're here. We weren't annihilated before we could form because there wasn't enough antimatter around to oppose all our normal matter. And that isn't something that our current theories can explain. Physicists are still searching for clues about antimatter, and it's tied up in this unexpected violation of parity symmetry. For all we know, there might be a mirror world on the other side of the universe asking these exact same questions. Maybe in the distant future, the answer will come down to a near-miss handshake.